these fora are always informal. They're meant to, they're never planned far in advance. James?
Yeah.
Actually, I'm not sure about
that. Yeah.
Thank you very much for coming to the latest Currents in Conversation forum, compelled by President Trump's most recent tirade, but more important by the anti-immigrant policies his administration is unleashing on legal, family-based immigration to this country. This series, intentionally informal in nature, as I've mentioned, provides a forum for the discussion of issues which have seized the public's attention and are of vital national and international import, holding specific and urgent implications for the study of race. The Currents forums, also as I suggested, are never planned very far in advance, as our objective is to seize the moment, taking direction from the headlines and the political winds. We like to think of the programs in this series as taking the Carnegie Woodson Institute to the public square, as it were, providing those who attend substantive and informed race, religion, and electoral politics. Occasioned by then presidential candidate Barack Obama's association with the Chicago minister Jeremiah Wright. The event then brought together students, faculty, and members of the broader Charlottesville community in a very spirited discussion about the place of religion in politics. Those were the days. Since then, we have hosted a range of panels, including those focused on race and the politics of the debt ceiling, race, wealth, and college admissions, race and predatory lending, and quite ironically, given our focus this evening, yelling in public, how should we handle hostile speech? You may be interested in hearing excerpts for the blurb we prepared for that spring 2010 event. This past week, news spread that a UVA student was the victim of a racist verbal attack by another student in a late night confrontation on the corner. We united with others throughout the university community in roundly condemning this attack. While unfortunate, this kind of incident is not unique to UVA and its environs, and thus it provides us an opportunity to think critically and broadly about what it suggests about the growing signs of incivility in public discourse. In addition to discussing steps that we might take to prevent future occurrences, we will consider such verbal hostility against the backdrop of recent developments in the Commonwealth of Virginia and in the nation more widely. We might ask whether or not the incident on the corner partakes of an apparent resurgence in hostile public speech across the country. Has the racist imagery and rhetoric of some Tea Party members begun to spill onto college and university campuses? What ramification does Governor McDonald's call to celebrate Confederate History Month have for race relations in the Commonwealth? That was true. How great. So long, so far away. Incivility, hostility, hardly suffice to describe the shitty state of public and political discourse. Happily, at the last minute, I could corral my colleagues to my left and right, all of whom have expertise in the topic under discussion this evening. further ado, I will give the floor to them, advising you that it is our custom at the Woodson Institute not to provide formal introductions. We provide brief bios, which should have been distributed to you. We'd rather give over all of the time and conversation to our panelists and then to you. Again, thank you for your presence. Robert Fetter. Yeah, she will move that. Thank you. She will give me one, hand me one.
Does that work? President Trump claimed that all Haitian refugees suffered from AIDS. Barely 3 weeks later, in negotiations about immigration reform, the president was a hypocrite. He called Haiti a shithole. In addition, the president allegedly rejected a bipartisan proposal to give green cards to Haitians who had been granted temporary protected status. Why do we need more Haitians, Trump asked. His next words were, take them out, meaning he presumed that Haitians should be removed from the pool of acceptable immigrants. Trump's statements outraged Haitians and people of Haitian descent, in part because the president ignored the accomplishment of notable Haitian immigrants. Two historic figures who immediately come to mind are Jean Dussard, the founder of Chicago, and W.E.B. Du Bois, the towering civil rights activist and intellectual, as well as one of the founders of the NAACP. And yet, the encounter of the Haitian other with white Americans on their own soil has always been fraught with contradictions, tensions, and apprehension. What is it about Haiti that has provoked such fury from President Trump? In answering this question, I wish to make 3 points. The first is that while Haiti has some beautiful beaches and lovely tropical enclaves where the wealthy reside, the majority of Haiti's rural and urban residents do live in very poor conditions and would actually welcome an opportunity to immigrate. Yet, we must recognize that the U.S. has played a major role in, and there's considerable responsibility for creating the current state of affairs. For many decades, Haiti has been besieged by the predatory rule of a series of vain and corrupt elites, most of them supported and financed by the United States. In fact, the US and other members of the so-called international community have a long and persistent history of interfering in and controlling Haiti's domestic affairs. In turn, unpopular and despotic Haitian leaders sought and obtained external assistance in their quest to conquer and maintain power. Haiti has thus been plagued by a malignant convergence of interest between opportunistic local politicians and external forces. Moreover, the country has endured the periodic and ravaging wrath of the gods of nature. The result is a society trapped in a maelstrom of poverty, inequity, and recurring political crisis. Not surprisingly, these conditions have contributed to the exodus of Haitians to more prosperous shores. As René Préval, the former president of Haiti put it, in a moment of extreme bluntness and desperation, he said that in Creole, c'est nager pour sortir, which means you have to swim away from Haiti to have the opportunity to make it. Many Haitians have thus sought to exit, like generations of others facing similar predicaments, like the British, the Germans, the Italians, and Irish who preceded them. Haitians have made America their destination. They are the new immigrants. And yes, they will continue to come as long as their country remains in dire economic and political straits. Second, we must address Trump's assertion that Haitian refugees are the AIDS-infected menace to America's health. This claim is not borne out by the facts. It is probably the legacy of the hysteria generated in 1983 when the American Centers for Disease Control identified homosexuals, hemophiliacs, heroin users, and Haitians as the four transmitters of AIDS, the so-called 4-H club. Of this club, Haitians were singled out as the only nationality to be inherently prone to the then mysterious disease. Trump, who defines himself as a germaphobe, may have thus developed his unfounded fear of Haitians from this bizarre and now discredited identification. Moreover, the containment of AIDS has been one of the few success stories of Haiti's weak health infrastructure. While it is true that the country has a high prevalence of the disease, the Joint UN Program on HIV/AIDS has pointed out that since 2010, new HIV infections have decreased by 25%, and AIDS-related deaths have decreased by 24%. Third, the repugnance that President Trump exhibits towards Haitians has deep and complex historical roots. In fact, Haitians have been an integral part of America's history and contributed to its very making. For example, in 1779, free men of color from Haiti joined American revolutionary troops in the siege and battle of Savannah in Georgia against the British. It was Haiti's defeat of Napoleon's army in 1804 that facilitated the Louisiana Purchase, which doubled the size of the United States. And yet, Haiti, the only nation born from a successful slave revolution, was a terrifying specter for America's founding fathers who owned slaves and defended slavery. Haiti was the embodiment of black liberation. It was therefore a mortal threat that had to be contained, tamed, and ultimately disfigured. America and the other white supremacist powers of the time did everything to undermine Haiti's prosperity and denigrate its people. They imposed embargoes and threatened military attacks. They were bent on making Haiti the emblem of a dysfunctional politics on the paradigm of underdevelopment, natural degradation, and poverty. Haiti was to serve as a warning to all colonies and people of color that revolting against the order of things would have violent and despoiling consequences, defying the West at its price. And Haiti had come to represent the symbolic reversal of the logic of progress and modernity. While Trump himself may or may not be aware of this history, he has clearly imbibed long-standing racist stereotypes of Haiti. These stereotypes have been reinforced by the recent and dramatic increase in the number of Haitian, African, and Central American immigrants in the United States. In 2016, according to government statistics, 500,000 people from North, South, and Central America and the Caribbean and another 111,000 from Africa became legal permanent residents of the United States. In addition, 440,000 Haitians obtained their green cards, but only about 98,000 Europeans were granted the same status. And not surprisingly, this influx of people of color has revived the nativistic and racist phobias expressed in 1924 when the US Congress passed an immigration overhaul that set strict quotas to give preferential treatment to immigrants from Western Europe. President Trump echoed these feelings when he angrily questioned why the United States should grant green cards to immigrants from shithole countries over people from places like Norway. Trump's comments, then, are not an aberration. They appeal to a large American constituency that has been marginalized from the benefits of globalization. It is a constituency that fears continuous economic decline and cultural denigration. It sees the foreigner, the other, of a different color or ethnic background as a threat to its overall sense of place and security. For those Americans whose towns and cities are decaying and whose own sense of worth has shrunk, racist and nationalistic phobias offer false but easy explanations. Such phobias become the pathological heaven in a world of grotesque inequalities of wealth and income. And I'm afraid that knowing this well, President Trump is bent on fueling this pathology. Paradoxically, Trump has another constituency, a large section of the small American plutocracy. Far from suffering the consequences of globalization, the plutocracy enjoys its benefits and seeks additional economic gains to the type of tax reforms recently engineered by the president that disproportionately rewards the 1%. By way of conclusion, let me say that Trump is neither the first nor the last to exploit immigration, nationality, and race to secure political power. Such exploitation will persist for the foreseeable future, not only here in America, but in Europe and elsewhere. One has only to observe the treatment of people of Haitian descent in the Dominican Republic to know that the problem goes beyond Trump's vile comments. In fact, one has only to examine how so many governments, including Haiti, marginalize their own citizens to understand that the shithole is in fact a metaphor for a disfigured planet. Unless we drastically change existing political and economic structures that created a world in which 42 individuals have as much wealth as 3.7 billion people, there is little hope that we will ever have real solidarity and genuine freedom of movement across borders. President Trump may be unique in his utter incapacity to restrain his verbal insults, but what he says and does are simply a symptom of a decaying and grotesquely unequal capitalist world order. It is an order that denies aspirations of global justice and solidarity. As Martin Luther King put it, and I quote, "Capitalism does not permit an even flow of economic resources. With this system, the small privileged few are rich beyond conscience, and almost all others are doomed to be poor at some level." That's the way the system works. And since we know that the system will not change the rules, we are going to have to change the system. End of it. Crafting this change is, of course, a huge task. but it is our only hope if we are to ever extricate ourselves from the global shithole.
Those comments by beginning in the 21st century and sort of working backwards. So I want to begin actually with two stories, because the argument that I'm making here today is that not only have US politicians been calling Haiti a shithole, albeit without using that exact terminology for two centuries, but they've actually been treating Haiti like a shithole for quite some time, and that treatment actually matters in thinking about how Haitian material realities came to be today. And so after the two stories, I'll have some comments about how these characterizations parallel 19th century treatments of Haiti, and especially discourses of the country coming out of the United States. So the first story. On February 17th, 2004, the US cable news network CNN covered the burgeoning coup d'etat week that would eventually force Haitian President Jean-Bertrand Aristide from power a second time and sent him into exile in the Central African Republic. The broadcast began with CNN anchor Wolf Blitzer. He said that increasing violence was, quote, pushing the country closer toward complete chaos. Blitzer then turned to David Enzer, a national security correspondent for CNN, who declared that though Haiti is not strategically important, it is close by. Enzer continued by noting that the US Coast Guard was on the watch for desperate Haitians, he said, who might try to make the dangerous journey to US shores. Shortly afterward, the former ambassador to Haiti, William Jones, evoked a familiar storyline when he suggested that he did not believe that, quote, the American taxpayer should be saddled once again for coming in and trying to solve the problem in Haiti, end quote. This broadcast simply added one more dimension to a phenomenon described by Robert Lawless as Haiti's bad press in his 1992 book of the same name. Such bad publicity for Haiti has been produced in large part by journalists from the countries that Brenda Gale Plummer has referred to as the great powers, the United States, France, Great Britain, and Germany. Much of the work of this bad press has been to continuously suggest that these world powers, with a little help from the United Nations, have been required to intervene in Haiti on many different occasions in various attempts to save the country from itself. So that was the first story. The second story. In 1997, 3 years following the return of Augustine and 7 years before he would be exiled again, Lee Hamilton, a US representative from the state of Indiana, spoke at a hearing before the Committee on International Relations. The hearing was called Policy Toward Haiti Following the Withdrawal of UN Forces, and it took place on December 9, 1997. Lee began by saying, let me just observe that I don't think we can save Haiti from itself. Haitian leaders simply have to understand that the international and the US presence in Haiti cannot long continue. They are going to have to get their act together. They don't have a lot of time to do it. They have to begin to assume responsibility for governing the country. If they don't, Haiti is going to return to the violence and the chaos that has marked much of its recent history. These two anecdotes involve different moments in Haiti's history with both the US and Aristide, but there is a web of relation between the two sets of commentary, and they're reinforcing the political imaginary effects how journalists in the CNN example talk about the country. For neither Lee nor the later CNN broadcast mentioned the fact that many of the people the media called rebels in both situations had US-backed paramilitary training, or that US dollars were used to support both Duvalier regimes long before the United States had decided to, in Enser's words, quote, help to ease out a military government and oversee elections in the Caribbean nation. Lee's comments, much like the later CNN broadcast, equally omitted the fact that the United States had funded the opposition to Aristide's candidacy in 1990 and had continued to fund opposition to him after he was democratically elected. Finally, there was no consideration given to the fact that the United States had attempted to destabilize the Haitian government dozens of times between 1857 and the turn of the century alone, which is precisely what we learn by reading the works of Patrick Bellegarde-Smith. We also should not fail to mention that the US military had occupied Haiti from 1915 to 1934. When Haitians rebelled against this occupation led by Charlemagne Perrault, the US Marines responded with increasing violence leading to thousands of Haitian deaths. So in other words, there was no attempt made to contextualize what was being described as violence and chaos, what Trump now describes as a shithole. In creating narratives about Haiti, in which the country appears as essentially disconnected from the world, strategically unimportant, politically incompetent, purveyors of Haiti's bad press have managed to mask the deep historical, political, and cultural relationship that Haiti has with the United States and also with the broader world system. In his foreword to Gina Aquino-Milese's recently published book, Why Haiti Needs New Narratives, Robin D.G. Kelly tells us, in my circles, there are two Haitis. There is Haiti the victim, the broken nation, the failed state, the human tragedy, the basket case, underbound by its own immutable backwardness, or destroyed by imperial invasion. The other Haiti, of course, he says, is the Haiti of the revolution, of Toussaint Louverture, Jean-Jacques Dessalines. This is the Haiti that led the only successful slave revolt in the modern world. Rarely do these two Haitis share the same sentence. Even though the Haiti of Toussaint Louverture and Dessalines paints the country in an exceedingly positive light, for Kelly, both narratives are problematic because they treat Haiti as a symbol, a metaphor, rather than see Haitians as subjects and agents, as complex human beings with desires, imaginations, fears, frustrations, and ideas about justice, democracy, family, community, the land, and what it means to live a good life. So one of the things that people have been asking is, how should we respond to these comments? Should we respond at all? Can we use narrative number two in Kelly's example to distract from, to dismantle narrative number one? Although a lot of people have been quoting Toni Morrison in these past days, I want to talk about why I think this particular quote of hers that people are using to suggest that we should not respond is taken out of context. And then I want to talk about why I think it is important for us to respond. So the quote comes from a 1992 speech that she gave at Oregon State University, in which she said, the function, the very serious function of racism is distraction. It keeps you from doing your work. It keeps you explaining over and over again your reason for being. Somebody says you have no language and you spend 20 years proving that you do. Somebody says your head isn't shaped properly, so you have scientists working on the fact that it is. Somebody says you have no art, so you dredge that up. Somebody says you have no kingdoms, so you dredge that up. None of this is necessary, she says. There will always be one more thing. I appreciate the statement in the context and spirit in which it was said, which is not the context in which the rebuttals and re-education about Haiti is being undertaken. What we need to understand Trump's comments is context. Is not to say, to suggest and prove the humanity of Haitians, it's to talk about Haitian history and the way in which it is intertwined with US and global history. And I do not think that Morrison would say that we should ignore racism, that we should silence it, that we should use our creativity to dismantle it. And in fact, when we look at her large body of work, which includes Playing in the Dark, which is perhaps her most famous scholarly work, as well as the now infamous interview that she gave to PBS's Charlie Rose, in which she corrected his racism on several occasions, particularly when he asked her why she didn't write novels about white people. And she pointed out that he would not ask that question to a white writer. As someone who specializes in 19th century Haiti, a time when Haitians were subjected to similar descriptions of victimhood, defenselessness, treachery, and even cannibalism. I continue to believe that silencing, ignoring the problem, or simply focusing on creativity, what we can create in these moments, are not the sole answers. What we need are multivalent responses, which I think is partially what we have seen. We've seen images of the beaches that Robert Fenton has mentioned. We've seen Conan O'Brien going to Haiti. We've also seen protests in the streets, shutting down the US Embassy in Port-au-Prince today. And we've seen myriad op-eds and scholars showcasing their work, providing deeper context for our understanding of Haitian history. We do not ignore such statements because they have real and immediate policy implications, as the work of Paul Farmer and so many others has shown us. In the uses of Haiti, Paul Farmer says that though Haiti may be a pariah nation, it may have many uses. Haitians have always understood the uses of their country for the powers that be. Laurent Dubois opens his 2012 book, Haiti, The Aftershocks of History, with a quote from the late 19th century historian and medical doctor, Louis-Joseph Janvier. For 80 years, Haiti has been judged, he quotes Janvier's writing in 1883. Since the birth of their country in 1804, Dubois writes, Haitians had been incessantly accused by outsiders, and it was time for them to respond. 19th century Haitians made it their mission to respond to racism about their country, stemming largely from France at that time and the United States in later periods, because they understood these racist statements to have real political consequences. In his foundational book, Haiti and the United States, National Stereotypes and Literary Imagination, J. Michael Dash tells us that representations of the Haitian Revolution in the 19th century world's literary imagination acquired real political meaning that requires that they be treated with a seriousness usually reserved for nonfiction. That is to say that even in unofficial creative texts, as the work of Morrison has also shown us, that these texts can create material consequences for the people that they describe. As such, Dash shows that the stereotypes about Haiti produced and continue to produce material political consequences, not the least of which was the US occupation of Haiti, which also involved the impounding of all Haitian government revenue by the National City Bank of New York in 1914. So if we can say that racist statements lead to racist actions, can we also say that the dismantling of those statements could dismantle the effects of the racist actions? Well, very recently, this past May, a law professor at Boston College suggested that Haiti should relinquish its sovereignty to Canada. He dredged up an entire compendium of narratives about Haiti designed to absolve Canada of any responsibility for Haiti's present situation and to suggest that the cures for Haiti's ills was, in fact, more colonization. He suggested that Canada should colonize Haiti. You can see my response to the article at Boy Magazine, Haiti definitely not Canada's Negroes. But if we listen to Haiti's earliest historians, we can see that they understood that the stereotypes about Haiti would lead exactly to the solution, which was more colonization. Early 19th century Haiti's Bernard Debatte, who wrote the first full-length history of the new country, published in 1819, said, French journals have been filled to the brim with the most outrageous articles against the personal character of Haitians. It is important for us to break our silence with the goal of rectifying public opinion. And to refute and dispute our calumniators, I am convinced that the great majority of persons in France live under the greatest delusion with respect to the true situation of affairs in Haiti. Convinced that the perpetuation of such errors are extremely harmful to both countries, I feel that I should perform this valuable service, not only for France and Haiti, but for humanity at large, thus rectifying public opinion and reinstating truth and justice. And over we find Haiti's earliest historians saying, the French have the right to publish lies about us, do we not have the right to respond? Which mirrors the material situation for Haiti and Haitians, because as Vante wrote, and I'll leave you with this, if certain men give themselves the right to subject other men to the most barbaric enslavement, cannot the enslaved give themselves the right to break these chains? So his justification of the violence for Haiti's revolution that had so often been defamed in the US, in US political discourse, and of course in French colonial discourse. That's all we know.
spend a bit of time talking about some of the things that go unspoken in recent discourse about immigration. Donald Trump has made some profane, vile remarks about immigration that should be condemned for many reasons that my colleagues have identified. Those remarks are being used to create policies that limit freedoms and have material implications in the lives of people around the world. At the same time, there are parts of his discourse about migration that are getting less attention. Words that he uses about migration that seem more benign, more palatable, and some of those words should concern us as well. I've especially noticed how the Trump administration is using a particular word, merit. The Trump administration has promoted migration based on merit in contrast to chain or family-based migration. I believe some code words and subtle racism associated with the language of merit that we've seen in policy debates related to blacks in the U.S. is also occurring in the administration's discussion of immigration policy. The Trump administration has called for us to focus on merit in immigration policy and to end chain or family reunification-based migration. Trump has tweeted, "Chain migration must end now. Some people come in and they bring their whole family with them who can be truly evil, not acceptable." A nativist group, Numbers USA, has also been running ads promoting this view. Their ad says, "When one person is given amnesty, Congress allows a chain of migration to begin that can include not only spouse and kids, but the couple's parents and the couple's siblings and their spouses, plus the spouse's extended families. A potentially never-ending chain, all possible from just one amnesty to one person." On one hand, this ad misleads people about how difficult it really is and how long it really takes to enter the U.S., gain citizenship in the U.S., and to support just one family member to move as well. The network diagram in the ad also implies, with the kind of scary-coded language of the commercial, that the U.S. will soon be overrun by people from other countries. And yet, there is another dynamic as well. In the distinction that the administration is promoting between merit and chain or family-based migration. The discourse maligns a very basic process, the idea that when we do things, we typically do them in collaboration with the people and institutions with which we're connected. And when we move from place to place, we typically do so with assistance from others. Often it is with the support of family, but it can also be with the support of friends, community members, or even institutions like colleges or our employers. This very idea that we move with the support of migrants who precede us or other social supports differs from the idea that individuals move alone, solely driven by a motivation to pursue economic incentives in new places. The social ties that facilitate moving occur within international migration. They occur among immigrants from Africa, the Caribbean, Asia, or Latin America. They also occur among European immigrants. One of the seminal articles about chain migration was published in 1964 by John and Beatrice McDonald. The article was about the ways European immigrants to the U.S., particularly immigrants from southern Italy, sponsored each other as they migrated here. The use of social networks to move from place to place also occurs among migrants within countries. Some of my own work examines the family, friendship, and community ties that facilitated African-American migration to the North during the Great Migration, and the social network ties that now facilitate Black migration to the South in the reverse migration. It's a very common phenomenon. And yet, we've seen an uptick recently in discussion of this basic process. An analysis by Media Matters showed that in the year 2016, Fox News used the term chain migration in its broadcast zero times. But in 2017, they used the term 295 times. The recent focus on this process in our popular discourse makes hyper-visible the family and institutional ties that immigrants of color draw on for support when they move. At the same time, the marriage versus chain or family-based migration discourse leaves unspoken the way social networks support whites. What becomes almost invisible in this discourse is the fact that many whites are here in this country through chain or family-based migration. In our political discourse, we are asked to interrogate and make hyper-visible the immigrant networks, family networks of former President Barack Obama. But we weren't asked to interrogate the immigrant family connections of someone like Bernie Sanders, who is the son of a Polish immigrant. In fact, the recent discourse leaves invisible the very social networks that have produced Donald Trump. Donald Trump's mother, Mary Ann Trump, is from Scotland, and she had a sister in the US before she arrived. Donald Trump's grandfather on his father's side, Friedrich Trump, immigrated to the US from Germany and joined a sister who was already living in the US. Donald Trump's wife, Melania, immigrated to the US from Slovenia, and her parents have now joined her here. And yet, these social ties that support families like Donald Trump's are made invisible. Instead, we are supposed to view people like Donald Trump as the worthy arbiters of merit. We are asked to view Donald Trump as a self-made man who attained his position through hard work, smarts, and quick business instincts. We hear little about his immigrant history or how social networks influenced his current position. When questioned about his biography, Trump admitted that he got his start in business with a, quote, small amount from his father. When pressed about how much that amount was, he admitted that it was about $9 million. Trump's social position was produced through family-based immigration and through wealth transmitted through his family networks. In the current immigration discourse about merit, we see this invisibility of the networks that have helped people from Europe to enter the US, and we see the hyper-visibility of the networks of support among immigrants from Latin America, the Caribbean, and Africa. This is familiar to me because of sociological research about merit as it relates to race and social policy in the US. This language about merit and social networks reminds me of the work of sociologist Deirdre Royster, who published a book entitled Race and the Invisible Hand. For this book, she interviewed black and white men in Baltimore who were pursuing blue-collar jobs in the early 1990s. She found that the white men benefited greatly from their connections to family, friends, and neighbors in getting access to jobs, while the black men did not. And yet, even with their many privileges of social ties to inner jobs, the white men still believed that the government and employers were set up to privilege racial minorities. The white men she interviewed thought that hiring decisions should really be based on merit. The discussion of merit and social networks also reminds me of sociologist Frank Sampson's research that shows how whites' definitions of merit are malleable. When a group of whites surveyed in California were primed to think about African Americans, they strongly supported the idea of merit, in this case, GPA for college admissions. But when white participants were primed to think about Asian Americans, they offered less support for the role of GPA for college admissions. Another sociologist, Nancy DiTommaso, conducted interviews with whites about equal opportunity and concluded the following. When whites get help from family and friends to get in the door, and thus are given the chance to prove themselves, they are not themselves meeting the standard of being the best person for the job, but they expect minorities and women to meet this standard when they think about public policy issues. This sociological research suggests that Donald Trump's discussion of merit in the context of our current immigration discourse has racial implications. The language more mundanely garners political support for his racially exclusive immigration policies. This language solidifies the myth that whites in the US have attained their position on the basis of individualism, hard work, and merit. It also solidifies the myth that people of color, in this case immigrants from Africa, the Caribbean, Latin America, are violating those cultural ideals. Moreover, this discourse about merit maligns the idea that our lives are social. The perceived threat of recognizing the social nature of immigrants' lives denigrates the idea that we have commitments to each other. It uses race-coded language to express that our commitments to each other are immoral and inefficient. It shifts us away from the ideas that we support each other through our families and that states should provide safety nets and social support to people. It makes less visible the global interconnectedness of people. We should keep our eyes on the profane and more overt expressions of racism in recent migration discourse, but we should also keep an eye on the more subtle expressions as well. Race-coded language is more palatable, but also leads to policies that are detrimental in the lives of people of color. It is the language embraced by those who condemn Trump's more overt expressions of racism when discussing immigration, while still supporting his racist immigration policies. And we must defend the idea that we are all interconnected, that we do things with the support of each other, and that we should recognize and support each other wherever we are on this earth to have safe and healthy lives.
Thank you very much, Amer. Professor McDonald, for changing this event. And what brought me this event was actually in Ghana, and somehow I'm beginning to reflect on the extent to which my education in Ghana, like, I've shaped how I actually receive this message, right? So then in terms of thinking about how the politics of education somehow influences how we engage with these kinds of incendiary comments. So I'd like to actually do something here. I would preface my discussion by actually drawing on a quote by Jackie Alexander on privilege, and this is what she says in her Pythagoras of Crossing, which is her 2005 book. She says, and I quote, "One of the habits of privilege is that it spawns superiority, beckoning its owners to don a veil of false protection so that they never see themselves, the devastation they wreak on their accountability to it. Privilege and superiority blunt the laws that issues from enforced alienation and segregations of different kinds." What I want to actually do here is basically outline the ways in which some African leaders responded to Trump's comment, and just how I responded to their comment to Trump. And I'm really doing this because the president of Ghana actually responded to Trump's statement as follows, and it's not like before, to for those of you who do not know his name. A good part of his response was also on Twitter. He goes, and I quote, "The language of Donald Trump that the African continent, Haiti and El Salvador, shithole countries is extremely unfortunate. We are certainly not a shithole country. We will not accept such insults, even from a leader of a friendly country, no matter how powerful." Right, so I'm particularly interested in just how some of these languages mask, right, what Akufo-Addo himself stands for in Ghana. And I'm doing this because my paper is basically entitled African Respectability Politics as a Politics of Appeasement. That in what ways do the reactions or responses of African leaders somehow really mask their own complicity in the kinds of statements that Trump makes? And of course, how does that also erase the fact that, you know, this is not the first time a statement like this has been invoked? I think that as intellectuals and scholars, as people who actually are also familiar with history, that somehow Trump's comment on Africa as a shithole continent, if you will, really resurrects, if you will, some of what Joseph Conrad says about Africa as the heart of darkness, right? And so there is really a genealogy or a history that really antedates Trump, really, or a history that shapes what Trump is saying. So I just really am interested in this because the day Akufo-Addo issued this statement, right, his response to Trump, it was a day he actually literally held a sweep of all the traders in the streets of Accra. Now, mind you, these are the working class people who touch the cities of Accra, and the streets of Accra, and are unable to afford or have the means, do not have the means to access stalls in the city. So what Akufo-Addo did was basically to deploy the police force to clear the streets of all these working class folks who are actually working efficaciously to earn a living, right, on this day. Now, another thing I really want to talk about is just how Africans in the United States, and this is to actually build upon what Sabrina said with regards to merit, that meritocracy, as it were, works in so many ways, that Africans' response to the statement was actually somehow very contradictory to me, because there was this desire on many parts of, on the parts of many, you know, African, especially middle class African immigrants, really, to mobilize their receipts, right, their receipts of achievement, right, to prove to Trump and to prove to white people that look at our accomplishments, right, this is what we have done, this is what we've been able to achieve. And that particular move somehow reprises, right, this, you know, lean towards merit, right, we've been able to draw on our merit to secure these, you know, accomplishments. And what that does is also mask the fact that Africans are not monolithic in this country, right? We do know that for a large part, or in a large measure, the lands of the cities of this country are completely filled with the drivers from continents, from the continent, right? And most of the drivers who actually enrich the lands of the cities, right, are from Ghana, from Gambia, from Guinea. They are hairdressers, right? People who actually sell on the streets of New York. Now, these are the working class folk whose narratives are never going to actually emerge in the ways in which these respectable Africans, these middle class Africans, responded to Trump. So, what I'm also trying to actually highlight here is that the response for me seemed a little anti-black, given the fact that, you know, there's a particular anti-African-American sentiment amongst Africans too, that somehow that receipt of the accomplishments, right, was to distinguish themselves from African Americans, that we've been able to achieve or make all these accomplishments. And here is how we are different. But then such difference really masks the sheer complexity of what Africans are doing and what African Americans are doing. And also it works to elide race, right, by actually foregrounding marriage as the, you know, the fundamental index for determining success, right? So when I talk about respectability politics, it's really something that is very profoundly common amongst how successful Africans like myself, if you will, I don't think I'm successful, but I'll call myself middle class, right? Become the poster child, right, of African success, forgetting the fact that there are people who are not like me and are always either refugees, right, who have been actually dislocated from their families, perhaps because of these long histories of colonialism, of civil wars, of civil strifes, and are here, but cannot actually come to where or make it to where I am at because of their refugee status, right? And I'm constantly having to confront, you know, legitimate citizenship per their refugee status. So I'm actually trying to push the argument further that how can we really think about this moment? How does it actually highlight, right, the ways in which, you know, respectable or middle-class Africans somehow mobilize the discourse of neocolonialism, right? And how does that discourse mask, right, their collusions or their complicity with neoliberals in Africa right now? Because if I hadn't been in Ghana, I might have a different reaction to this. But I think my presence in Ghana actually compelled me to think about the fact that, well, Trump's statement perhaps opens a vista for us to really have real conversations about the continent, about how our leaders are in cahoots with Western leaders in exploiting the poor in Africa, right? That people in many parts of Africa, and let me speak to Ghana, that there are so many people in Ghana who do not have access to potable drinking water. Why is that? Because the watershed supplies we have been sold to Anheuser-Busch. Right, so here we have an opportunity to basically highlight those unimagined affinities that are completely invisible in these conversations. That in what ways are these the desire to actually refer to Africa as a Chicano country, how does it make us or give us an opportunity to really return to our leaders and really talk to them about their complicity with Western leaders, right? And not just that, we can talk about militarization. We can talk about the fact that here you have two presidents, one of whom is actually a male African leader, and a Western white leader who's also male, ruffling shoulders. So there are ways in which we can actually complicate what is happening right now if we should think about gender, if we should think about queer coming, right? And not just class, but the fact that these other iterations of identity allow us to think about the Kufuor's response to Trump as two men trying to fight amongst like each other. Mm-hmm. Let's forget about the fact that women in Ghana don't earn as much as men. Right? Women in Ghana are constantly stripped off of them. Do not have access to property, because access to property is contingent on one's gender, the fact that they are male. Right? That if a woman has access to property, they have to do so through their husband. So for me, this opportunity actually occasions a moment for us to really attempt to distill these many complexities, right? And so very often I'll be the person to call Trump out and actually center him in my conversation, but quite frankly, he doesn't matter to me right now. The people who matter to me are the people who continue to face the brunt, right, of those who are complicit in the creation of shitholeness, wherever, right, the shithole spaces in the US, the shithole spaces in Ghana, that these are the kinds of issues we need to basically emphasize or amplify. So if Professor Robert is talking about the fact that 1% of the world's population have access to 3.7 billion, no, sorry, have access to almost 50% of the world's wealth, this is what we are talking about. It's precisely because this 1% collude with each other, right, and give us the impression that they are divisions. And here we have an opportunity to just show that, well, these are this division between the elite in Ghana and the elite in the West is just a fiction, right? That we have an opportunity to actually also return to history to understand the ways in which nationalists have now become the new the governing class. And in the sense that their class consciousness aligns so well with the interests of the Western class, that they are the people who precisely execute what these Western leaders want them to do. But then they can actually stand on the platform of speech of global politics and perform this, perform the script. I can call you out because we are not together. Meanwhile, when you go to the backstage, the Kufuor is colluding with Trump. So these are the kinds of collusions we have to actually capitalize on this opportunity to lay bare, right? And of course, I'm really very excited that he gave us the history. You outlined the histories of the colonial and the histories of slavery and the histories of colonialism. Now we have to contend with the very the intersections, if you will, of neoliberalism and neocolonialism, because that is what many of the people, right, in these spaces that are being referred to as shithole spaces are contended with. The fact that the behemoths of neoliberalism and neocolonialism are always somehow wedded, and that this wedding is so nefarious because its impact on the poor in Ghana are so destructive. Thank you very much.
I think it's probably it's okay. Fine. Yeah, okay. People can project.
Thank you all for your comments. Can you all talk a little bit about how Trump's this particular language about immigration and who are the respectable immigrants are, how that is comparing to how this particular administration appeals to like a white spatial imaginary, like what is like we know, like, Coates calls this guy, like, the first white president for, like, his specific appeals to whiteness. So can you talk a little bit about, like, the like his outward looking, and then his also, like, how he talks about, like poor black folk and, like, in the United States?
So I know there's been some work on, I mean, I think this kind of dominant ideology has been a kind of hard work merit, right? The myth that there is equal opportunity, right, has been used, you know, it's been used in lots of different debates in relation to blacks in the U.S., right? I mean, look at the debates around, you know, kind of welfare reform, right? We have a visibility of black families, we have a visibility of the state recognizing black families, right, to perhaps get access to state resources, but the kind of transfers of wealth from the state that are going to white families have not been as visible. And caught up in all of that kind of discussion were these kind of discussions of hardworking, you know, versus the lazy, you know, the kind of idea of merit, just these, you know, what we call kind of symbolic boundaries that accompany the policy decisions, right? And so I think that kind of language, right, plays to, as you know, my colleagues have discussed, you know, whites who have felt kind of the loss of jobs, right, the kind of economic devastation, right, associated with globalization, and that they, you know, holding up black people, immigrants, as they are the problem, right? Yeah, they are the scapegoats. That's occurred, right? And so it's occurred in many different kinds of debates, affirmative action, welfare reform, all different kinds of debates among African Americans, in relation to African Americans. And then I think we're also seeing it now here, right, in this kind of debate about immigration and how it should come. Mm-hmm.
Anyone else? Any comments or questions?
One thing. And it relates to mainstream economics that is presented as scientific. And it really reproduces exactly what you're talking about, which is merit. I mean, if you look, for instance, at the tax proposal, the idea is that you have to reward supposedly the most productive and the most hardworking people. So therefore, what you're doing is very rational. Wealthy people, by necessity, are more productive, they are smarter, blah, blah, blah. So you need to give them tax breaks so they can deploy on a more expanded basis the very capital that they've taken from the rest of the people. And it's presented as really something amazing. When we listen to the news, oh my goodness, look at Facebook, or look at whatever company has given $1,000. Well, that matters to people who have money. But this is peanuts. It's outrageous. You give them a tax break when they have literally trillions of dollars stacked in offshore places. And then they give $1,000. Oh, this is wonderful. But people who want to really fight that have to be careful, because when you get $1,000 and you leave paycheck to paycheck, it has significance. And when you are a poor white in West Virginia, and you see your community being destroyed, the idea that maybe the immigrants are connected to that is a very powerful thing. So it's a very complex and contradictory world.
And especially when the fine print of this largesse no one takes account of, it didn't take anyone long to realize that the so-called $1,000 bequest from Walmart to workers, really, that only people who had been in the company for 20 years were eligible for $1,000. That on average, people got 200. Or we don't hear that for every $1,000 Walmart might actually dispense, the day following the bequest, it closes hundreds of Sam's Club stores. This store, the smoke and mirrors, and we as much as I hate Trump's recurrent use of the fake media, I think really our media could do better to nuance some of these details. Our media really fails to really inform the public. We should not have these announcements go unchecked. That for every announcement that Walmart is giving $1,000 to workers, there should be a journalist with follow-up questions and follow-up information, because there are the smoke and mirrors. The Republicans, exploit that fact. And what is happening now is far from new. I don't remember, someone did resurrect the famous Willie Horton ads, because what is happening with this administration to undergird or to give reinforcement to its opposition to immigration, even legal immigration, it seems, for certain people, is to try to attempt to associate immigration with criminality, all right? And that, so Willie Horton, the famous Willie Horton ad, where Willie Horton receives a prison furlough under Michael Dukakis and comes out, and I mean, this is the playbook. These people have absolutely no shame, and it is our responsibility to, wherever we are, which is why we are in this hall tonight, to try to disseminate whatever other information we can provide our student bodies, student body, and our constituents. Anyone else? Keisha?
Because I've heard a lot from the youngest thing, who's a brave person. And I think about what's happened to most of these countries is that America needed certain workers, right? Okay. So when you think about nurses and doctors and teachers, and they went to the Caribbean, Africa, and Latin America. So what do you think about that and how this plays into the conversation in terms of the immigrants that came, even with in terms of merit, right? When it's not just that anyone could come, right? So it's typically some of the smartest people or rich folks from these countries. That opportunity to come.
And then connected, excuse me, Keisha, is and these people were running in tandem with or in parallel to guest workers, well and perhaps overrepresented at Mar-a-Lago. The people from Haiti's shithole are working at Mar-a-Lago as guest workers. I mean, these things have to be called out. And our journalists are derelict, it seems to me, are negligent. I'm sorry, you weren't even asking me the question.
Well, I think there's a contradiction in all of us. I mean, after all, he's from Ghana, I'm from Haiti,
yeah.
You're from Haiti, and probably, do you have a dissonance in the kind of
So you're legitimate. What?
So we are all here. But this is the reality. When you have few opportunities, you exit. And this has been the history of migration. There is nothing bizarre about it. What is interesting is that the number of people who migrated have not really increased significantly in terms of the percentage of the population of the globe. It was about less than 2% in the 40s. It is about the same now. So it's a rather limited number. And those of us who are here in this particular room, we are really very privileged nomads. We can go anywhere. The fellow I work with, like the guest worker, or the person who has to take a boat in order to exit, those are qualitatively different people. The problems that they have, we do not have them. They are different, it's a completely different understanding. And when you get here and you don't have any legal papers, the existential crisis that you must face. Every minute you go out, I'm not going to be stopped. And if I'm stopped, I don't have pictures, I'm not going to be. We don't face them. So we don't know what that is. And that is really a reflection of inequalities. People don't necessarily want to migrate when things in their own particular locality are fine. You may want to travel, you want to know what else is there. But the idea of extricating yourself from your own community, your family, the environment where you've been living, it's a very difficult thing. And so when you move, it's because you really, to some extent, it's particular people who are extremely poor, they don't have any other alternatives. Us, we are kind of lucky we have more than one.
Yes, sir.
There's actually historical evidence of using immigrants to interfere with job organization in West Virginia, Southwest Virginia, during the 1880s, 1890s, early 1900s. In the coal mines, the coal miners, executives, the owners of the companies, brought in Eastern Europeans, Southern Europeans, African Americans from the South, knowing that the white Appalachians would never join with these people in unions, and that way they were able to keep the unions busted.
Absolutely.
The same thing is going on now by focusing on race and showing these divisions. It's a way to keep people from uniting against the powerful rich people. It's a way to keep them working at low wages because they're so scared they're gonna get deported that they're not gonna rise up. It's there's very strong economic motivations behind most of this.
That's absolutely the case. Absolutely.
And I think that is what you actually somehow see with the responses a lot of Africans have had, right? That there's this desire to actually appear as the respectable, the very, you know, the privileged African subject, right? And then, so such representation is somehow contingent on other Africans as, you know, not respectable, right? Not proper, right? Because there are those proper Africans like, you know, myself and someone else who have come here through particularly legal means. And there are those who are actually here because they are undocumented, right? So now I think the responses have been like that. And what they do again is to actually, and just what I'm trying to say is that it must be complex that these discussions of this rhetoric Trump is spewing is mobilized to divide, right? It's to create divisions amongst the working class who could actually like mobilize themselves to respond to this system that continues to prey on them, right? But that's not what's happening. Now you do have people wanting to actually stake a claim for themselves. And how do they do that? They have to actually, you know, present themselves as accomplished. I am not like this person, right? Even though we all come from Africa, I am not from the sheeple. I am different from the person who comes from the sheeple, right? So evidently they are not erasing or even doing anything to upset that logic of the sheeple, but then to distinguish themselves as exceptional. I'm not from the sheeple, is really what's going on.
Yeah,
does
he look at, yes, James.
Oh, yeah, this isn't a very fully formed question, but just sort of an observation, a related observation in the way in which sort of after, you know, amid all the incendiary comments, you know, days later, ICE goes and raids a bunch of 7-Elevens to target undocumented workers. You know, after a few weeks later, you know, the administration deports a Haitian immigrants activist, Jean Montrevil, who has been here legally for years, for decades. 40 years, yeah. And so I guess my question, I mean, and this is kind of a layering of the security state on top of what we're describing, but sort of the, I'm curious if you can maybe speak about, I mean, maybe that's like a layering of victim and revolutionary. I don't know, Marlena, I like that conversation about those two narratives. But if you can maybe speak more about the way that in some ways the clampdown that is happening behind the scenes is also one that is targeting protests and targeting activism in order to ensure the rights of those who are undocumented and refugees and immigrants that are coming into this country, that in some ways the smoke and mirrors actually goes another step deeper to in some ways break up movement organizing in addition to sort of labor rights.
I mean, I would say that, so if thinking about politics of meritocracy, politics of criminalization of the immigrant, politics of respectability, then the other aspect is the politics of blame that's involved in all of this. this, right? When the Homeland Security, when TPS was first being sort of discussed over the summer, the expiration of TPS for Haitians over the summer, and the New York Times ran an article quoting several officials from the Homeland Security Department, an internal memo in which they said, find some criminal Haitians, like who've done some, and then like disseminate it around so that people will understand and think about Haitians in a certain way. And so the politics of blame works to suggest that if you only came here legally, if you only did things the right way, you became the right kind of immigrant, then you'd be able to stay. And of course, this politics of blame works across the spectrum, particularly when we're dealing with race and ethnicity in this country, right? We can think about Katrina, why didn't you do this? Why didn't you leave? Why didn't that things are somehow your own fault? And I think this is largely the conversation when it comes to African countries, often treated as a monolith, but certainly with Haiti and Haitians, that both people can't stay because they didn't come here legally. Why don't they do things like other people? Why can't Haitian leaders, in the two examples that I gave, take responsibility for their own people? So I would say that how ICE now, and with the expiration of TPS, et cetera, how this all functions is to divide people so that the poor working class in the United States think that by deporting a bunch of Haitians, their lives will somehow be better. And so that is the part that's the distraction, is that deporting Jean Montrevil will not do anything for people who are about to lose their health care. And when the Trump administration was on TV, on Fox News talking about it, they said, we want to reward people for living a good life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just one other, not so much directly coming from your comments, but related, Marlena, doing things the right way, all right? So chain migration can be condemned, right? But as we speak, it's not been a secret in the media that a whole range of women have come into this country from Russia to give birth to babies who will then be U.S. citizens upon birth. This is happening right now. Jared Kushner can promise people an expedited route to a green card for purchasing some property in one of his many buildings. And so we have to basically keep the pressure on countering these arguments whenever the opportunity arises. No one is talking about the fact, and these Russian women have willingly submitted to interviews. It's not as if they are being secretive about this. My friend, Michael.
Well, I'm sorry,
I just had a quick response to that. I wanted to add is that some of them are staying at Trump property.
Yeah, precisely, are staying at Trump property.
In response to James's point, as you were talking, I was thinking about that this question of the interconnections, and particularly between the immigrants with the detention and deportation and rights activists and the surveillance around Black Lives Matter also happening right now too. And the need to see how those processes worked kind of in tandem, right? The increase, particularly in the late 1990s, some of the laws about kind of drug enforcement that were passed that had detrimental effects among Blacks in the U.S., but also, right, led to this kind of criminalization, right, of kind of border enforcement, right, of immigration policy. We also see kind of around that time this connection between kind of the federal government and local law enforcement kind of increasing, right? And so we see people, police, sheriffs working kind of on their own accord in terms of the engaging with kind of people migrating into their community. And underlying, much of this includes kind of the profits, right, that are coming in these private prisons who are building detention centers, and prisons, right, and, for
detention. We see kind of the lack of due process occurring among folks who are being detained. And this kind of request that we kind of self-regulate ourselves, right? We point out the people, right, who shouldn't be here, right? So we see this process happening. And so your comment about kind of poverty-related social movements makes me kind of think about this, you know, the increasing surveillance we've seen around kind of Black Lives Matter activists, and now also kind of with immigrants' rights activists who are being deported, right? Just thinking more about those interconnections as well.
And I want to make a quick addition because it's easy for us to also scapegoat Trump, that Obama actually deported more people, and so you see that the increase in deportations during Obama's presidency was what actually spread, right? The emergence of a lot of these immigrant activist groups. So we do have like the Underground Black Network, which basically came up during the Obama presidency, and it was in response to Obama's, you know, unleashing, you know, like his probably his administration deporting people like that without us knowing, the silent deportations.
Yeah, this is a long history, right? I mean, it's not just Bush, it's Clinton. Some people may not have followed Clinton's ascendancy. But there's a very famous picture of Clinton with Sam Nunn, and one was the third governor, Zeller.
Yes.
And that was the picture of the tree in front of the monument at Stone Mountain, where, in fact, this is where the modern KKK was created.
Yes.
And he took that picture to show literally to whites, I'm not a radical, you can trust me, I'm a Southerner. And the very following week, he flew back to Arkansas. There was a black a prisoner on death row who was mentally incapacitated, and went there to show that he was for the death penalty, and that guy was executed. So there's a long history. Then you have the history of the predators, the young people,
yeah.
The predators. Then you have the history of criminalization of drugs. All of that, there is a real series of things. So when we talk about Trump as a rupture, I don't see it at all as a rupture. It's continuity with a vengeance on steroids.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
And it is the policy that these predecessors put into place from before, when Jefferson was vice president, called Haitians cannibals of the terrible republic, and partially the response that some people are saying, you know, this is distracting us, the response actually came from the United States to the Haitian revolution. The United States was the one that responded to the revolution negatively, occasioning a series of other and longer responses that also involved occupations and deportations and disturbed elections. That is all the U.S. responding, and then it creates sort of ricocheting effects in the world, in a sense.
And the instability they perpetuate, this country perpetuates around the globe. Mm-hmm. Right, it is absolutely the case. Maybe we will take two more questions. Maurice and Michael. Mm-hmm.
I want to thank all the panelists. I thought it was terrific. And to use some of Marlene's language for the power and insight with which you spoke back. One of the particular details in the conversation tonight, which I appreciated deeply, was Robert's invocation of King. And I say that having, of course, we're only days removed from the birthday, the national recognition of Dr. King's birthday, and I see and despair, frankly, of the ways in which the King legacy has been so thoroughly depoliticized. And Forbear, invoking King in this context, it is another form of speaking back, which I think is very, very valuable, to us, especially in light of the ways in which the state has now turned that celebration, as it were, into a day of service. And the idea that a certain kind of national voluntarism can now substitute for responsibility that the state should have, right, in seeing to the well-being of the least among us, let's say, and the ways in which not just the state bear, you know, the responsibility of the state is obscured, but the ways in which the elite who, like Trump, can sign a formal declaration of observation and then go play golf, right, seems to naturalize the conditions of poverty and inequality in our country and leave it to the rest, right, leave it to others, leave it to the middle class to serve the underclass, let's say, or those who are in need of the kind of service and volunteerism that is imagined when we think about a day of service. Of course, I am not, nor can I imagine anyone is opposed to service, but the idea that we could nationalize a day of service and have it have such a dulling effect on our politics, to have it not, in fact, be a day where we call for a political organization or political education, but something that seems so benign as to appeal to a certain national affect for the underserved, and simply manage that in a day, I think, is tragic and despairing. So I thank you for all your contributions. It was all brilliant, and thank you, Robert, for your work as well with Dr. King.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. My question, is it an accident that I'm hearing the same rhetoric of race, racism, and immigration in England right now, in Germany right now? Is it random?
I think it's globalized. And I think actually, when you think about it, it's even worse in Europe. I mean, if you listen, for instance, to Macron, who's presented that as a liberal guy, there were immigrants in Calais. Well, the French call it the jungle. So last week, Macron was there and said very publicly and repeated it, there will be no more jungle in Calais. And the rhetoric of marriage that Trump is using is exactly the rhetoric of Macron. And what is worse is that many of these refugees came from Syria and Libya. The British and the French bombed the hell out of those countries. And then they come, because you destroyed their country, and say, get out. It's rather ironic. And you see our information. You go and destroy their country, and you say, you know, you can't come here.
And in Algeria, the French in Algeria, another country, they destroyed there, and they wonder why.
But also the fact that a lot of the immigrants, they were applicants, right? So then the idea of the jungle itself,
exactly,
right, has this connotation of, you know, Africanness, of blackness, right? And so thinking about the ways in which Macron has recently conducted so many trips back to Africa, trying to compel African leaders to, you know, really keep the African youths from traveling to Europe. And this is how he conveyed it, that, you know, because currently Africa is the most youthful continent. And this is one of the things that we have to perhaps think about, that, you know, so Macron is basically, of course, symbolically serving as the colonial mother, right, who goes to instruct these African leaders. Most of them are actually truly older than Macron, and are winning these things of authority for much longer, that they need to take care of the African youth, right, and to ensure that they actually devise policies that would open opportunities for them. But clearly, again, this is really what I consider as shady, because these very leaders and the leaders of the French administration are always colluded, right? And so any attempt at providing or provisioning opportunities for the African is literally impossible, because these possibilities are already compromised, right? And again, that's how the colonial, neoliberal corruption works, right?
And I would say that, I mean, to add to that, that based on your comments just now, Deborah's comments earlier about looking at the fine print, right? So when one thing that struck me, the president of God's statement is, from a nation that we like basically ordinarily consider to be friendly, right? When we think about the French presence in West Africa, the amount of troops, the amount of, in the their equivalent of the State Department, of people, basically diplomats, that they have on the ground in West Africa is astonishing. Compared to the population of their country and the population of Africans, West Africans in France. And so what are they doing there? Well, colluding is a good word, with the friendly nation of Senegal. And why should Senegal and the Ivory Coast be friendly with the France that colonized them and that brought a lot of destruction that continues to this day?
And one thing we need to think about is maybe highlight the fact that black bodies were, you know, the whole enslavement of black bodies in Libya, right? And how did we get there, right? How is it that African migrants who happened to be in Libya were actually subject to these kinds of gross inhumanity, right? That Europe, the EU had to be in Libya, really, to sabotage or to actually prevent Africans from actually using Libya as an entry point into Europe. Right, so somehow the kinds of narratives, and thank you for actually bringing up the fact that, you know, the media literally spawns these single dangerous narratives, right, that basically mask and sort of prevents us from having access to, okay, what are the histories behind these conditions? That nobody is aware that the EU had to be in Libya. And that the fact that Gaddafi is no more, thanks to ex-president, right, was precisely because of that, that we could actually think about the genesis of these rather insidious events in Libya, to not only the death of Gaddafi, but the fact that the EU, especially Italy, somehow paid off Libya, right, to just make sure that migrants from Africa or refugees from Africa don't make it across the Mediterranean into Europe. So this is, these are some of the conversations we need to have.
And this is also very important because there are two players. The two powers, locally and internationally. So when you talk about US imperialism, first you define the French imperialism, we know that. But there is a complicit local elite. So, you know, to some extent, some say, not else, and, you know, So we have that contradiction. And it's the same thing, and this is something that is inconvenient to say, but has to be said. When we're talking about temporary protected status, the people who want that to be extended is because they do think, inevitably, that those people are in danger, that there is a shithole. And this is why we have to protect them. And the contradiction of it is that when you read Trump's administration saying that it should be stopped, saying everything is fine nowadays, they have recovered. So you can send them back, they'll be fine. Yeah. So there is that contradiction, but there is the other contradiction that yes, you can go back because it's horrible. So we are really in that kind of very peculiar moment in history where, you know, movement, has always been the case, is a symptom of the wider economies, the wider form of politics. And one of the things that we didn't talk, obviously, is that a fairly large number of people migrated against their will.
Yes. And, and therefore, is migration an operable term, or is that a gross inaccuracy? You're talking about the Atlantic slave trade.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's not migration. We could say the migration as a matter of speaking.
Yeah,
but here, then, the inexactness of the terminology just stares you in the face.
Yeah.
Well, we are at the end of the evening, and I wanted to thank you on behalf of my colleagues for, again, for your presence. We have but scratched the surface. As I say, on the spur of the moment, when something is presented to us, such as Trump's comments, which I think Kwame is right, cannot be taken in a vacuum, nor are they reducible to Trump. Trump's comments, however deplorable and offensive they were, represent a long history. It's not new. There is no point that we can slice the historical timeline and not find this anti-immigrant sentiment. I'm thinking of the popularity of a series of books in the 20s, one by an author starter called The Rise and Tide of Color, or The Rise of the Colored Races. And so this anxiety about race and immigration has long been with us, and politicians exploit this as well as other wedge issues when it suits them, and most people are none the wiser. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of your evening.